Good morning. God is good. Welcome to our worship this morning. A few announcements about upcoming activities and opportunities for service. This afternoon, our men's ministry invites anyone who's interested to join them in assisting with the gathering table meal at the Salvation Army. From 4 to 6:30, help them in preparing the meal and then serving it. It's a very special, very rewarding experience, and there's opportunities for serving for young and old. I've seen, 11 and 12-year-olds participate and contribute towards that, as well as adults. And again, that begins at 4 o'clock at the Salvation Army at 3rd and Eddy, and any available and interested are welcome to join them. Out in the gathering area, there's a couple of displays about ways that you can support the group that is attending the National Youth Gathering. I will be going along with Julie Rayner and Anna McCoy and McKenna Marsh. And one of the ways that you can support us is by signing up and spending part of an hour in prayer for us during that week. And there's a board out there where you can get that list going for us. Also, there are financial contributions that we'll be inviting you to consider in a couple of weeks. And also, there are books that are needed by the schools in Houston on account of the hurricane that devastated that community last fall. And so contributions of specific books are appreciated. That information is on the youth board out in the gathering area. Later this morning during our worship service, we're going to be receiving some information and some reports, some sharing from our voting members that attended the Synod Assembly last weekend in Kearney. They'll be sharing about some of the activity that happened there and some of the decisions that went on, and we look forward to hearing from them and sharing with all of you about last weekend. With that, I invite you to turn in your bulletins to our order for confession and forgiveness as we begin our worship together. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, full of compassion and mercy and abounding in steadfast love. Amen. Trusting in God's promise of forgiveness, let us confess our sin against God and against one another. All may remain seated or kneel. Eternal God, our Creator, in you we live and move and have our being. Look upon us, your children, the work of your hands. Forgive us all our offenses, and cleanse us from proud thoughts and empty desires. By your grace, draw us near to you, our refuge and our strength, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Brothers and sisters in Christ, since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit given to us. And in the mercy of Almighty God, Christ died for us while we still were sinners. And for his sake, God forgives us all of our sins, God's people say. Amen. Stand and join in singing. the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to God's people on earth. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. All-powerful God, in Jesus Christ you turned death into life and defeat into victory. Increase our faith and trust in him that we may triumph over all evil in the strength of the same Jesus Christ, our Savior and our Lord. Amen. Congregation may be seated. I invite the children to come forward for a moment with them. I invite Mitch to come forward, and we continue with our readings.
This morning's lesson is a reading from the Book of the Beginnings, Genesis chapter 3. They heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden at the time of the evening breeze, and the man and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God among the trees of the garden. But the Lord God called to the man and said to him, "Where are you?" He said, "I heard the sound of you in the garden, and I was afraid, because I was naked and I hid myself. He said, who told you you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree from which I commanded you not to eat? The man said, the woman whom you gave to be with me, she gave me fruit from the tree, and I ate of it. Then the Lord God said to the woman, what is this that you have done? The woman said, the serpent tricked me, and I ate. The Lord God said to the serpent, because you have done this, cursed are you among all animals and among all wild creatures. Upon your belly you shall go, and dust you shall eat all the days of your life. I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and hers. He will strike your head, and you will strike his heel. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand for our gospel acclamation. Holy Gospel according to St. Mark in the third chapter. Jesus went home, and the crowd came together again so that they could not even eat. When his family heard it, they went out to restrain him, for people were saying, he has gone out of his mind. The scribes, who came down from Jerusalem, said, he has Beelzebub, and by the ruler of the demons, he casts out demons. And he called them to him and spoke to them in parables. And then he said, how can Satan cast out Satan? If a kingdom is divided against itself, that kingdom cannot stand. And if a house is divided against itself, that house will not be able to stand. And if Satan has risen up against himself and is divided, he cannot stand, but his end has come. But no one can enter a strong man's house and plunder his property without first tying up the strong man. Then indeed the house can be plundered. Truly I tell you, people will be forgiven their sins, whatever blasphemies they utter. But whoever blasphemes against the Holy Spirit can never have forgiveness, but is guilty of an eternal sin. For they had said, he has an unclean spirit. And then his mother and his brothers came. Standing outside, they sent for Jesus. They called for him. A crowd was sitting around him. And some in the crowd said to him, your mother and your brothers and sisters are outside asking for you. And Jesus replied, who are my mother and my brothers? Looking at those who sat around him, he said, here are my mother and my brothers. Whoever does the will of God is my brother, my sister, and my mother. This is the living gospel of Jesus Christ. Congregation may be seated. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Last year, during one of our worship services, I think it was in the season of Easter, we shared a video message from Pastor Irwin McManus, reflecting on that story from Genesis 3, when the Lord asked Adam, who said you were naked? Pastor McManus suggested by saying this, God was really asking Adam something else. That God was really asking Adam, whose story about your life did you exchange for mine? God had given Adam life and a vision and a purpose and a clear understanding of who and what Adam was as a child and as a creation made in God's own image. Adam's anxiety and shame about being naked demonstrated to God that Adam was settling for an alternate vision of the life that he'd been given, an alternative worldview, a different reality from the one that God had placed in him. So God asked, "Who said you are naked? Who is offering you an identity and a story, and for that matter, values and interests in place of the ones that you have from me?" That notion of identity and belonging, whether it comes from God or whether it comes from others, is also a big part of the situation in our gospel text this morning. I want to first say a few words about Jesus' statement at the end of the gospel reading. Those words about his mother and his brothers and his sisters. There are some who come on this text, who come across this text, and the words that Jesus shares and mistakenly read them as Jesus rejecting his biological family. But even though in the moment he is saying this as a way of refusing their request to come away with them, Jesus' mother, Mary, and his brothers, James and the others, continue to be dearly loved and dearly cared about by Jesus. And we need look no further than some of his final words from the cross. The conversation that Jesus has with John and with his mother to see that. Jesus' words here are not offered as a way for him to pick sides between his family and the scribes and the crowd. Although that is, in a sense, what's happening here. The scribes are circling their wagons, so to speak, and deciding and settling who is allowed to speak for God and who isn't allowed to speak for God. And Jesus isn't in their circle. So clearly, Jesus must be with the enemy. Jesus' family is looking to pull him away from his mission because of their concern for him and playing the card that they need to come first, which in the Jewish culture they had more than ample support and reason to do. So Jesus is in the midst of this situation where others are pulling him or pushing him away, and sides and factions are being formed. And Jesus speaks into this not to announce what side he's on. Jesus speaks into this situation to announce that he's not a part of any of that, that he's moving beyond sides, that he's moving beyond factions, and that he's calling all of them to do the same thing, because his words are about a truth that's bigger than all of that. His words are not about moving him from this circle of community into that circle of community, but his words are about opening them up to seeing that all of these little circles, all of these little communities, all of these little tribes that are happening around him, that they're all a part of something so much bigger, that they're all called and commanded to recognize their place in something so much bigger. And we all too, We all too have these circles of belonging and identity. Circles that we find ourselves a part of or not. Circles that give us strength, give us support, give us confidence and safety. Circles that form around our activities, around our career, around our interests, around our ideologies, around the community that we're a part of, the state that we live in. And through our lives, through our words and through our actions, we come to sort of advertise these things, these circles of belonging and identity, much like the labels and images on our clothing. So as God asked Adam, who said you were naked, he might ask us, who are you wearing? Who are you projecting? Whose story are you projecting? Whose vision are you projecting? Whose story about this world and creation are you exhibiting? As God looks on these circles that hold us and feed us, but also limit us. Circles defined by what church you do or don't belong to, what school you're a part of, your ideology, your beliefs on some social issue or another, or sports or other things we're passionate about. Each of these circles, God invites us to something much larger. In the gospel, Jesus is confronted by the scribes. They see him teaching and drawing crowds, which is a problem because, as I said, he's not a part of their circle. He can't be sharing God's word. But Jesus isn't interested in those little circles. Jesus is interested in a larger circle. The circle that Jesus cares about is the circle that covers all those who do the will of God, who love and serve the Lord. And when Jesus says that those around him who share God's word, who do God's will, are his mother and his brother and his sister, what Jesus is saying is that wherever those things happen, he's home. Wherever those things happen, we are home as well. Where those things happen, there is family. Where those things happen is where we are free and loved and supported. The circle of the kingdom of God, the people of God. One of the resolutions at the assembly last weekend was a passionate appeal from one of the pastors in the synod. An appeal having to do with the church making its voice known in a time when we see a lot of deep divisions and conflicts and disagreements in communities and amongst families and among different groups, the circles and the tribes in our midst, so to speak. It was a resolution that called for a process to support churches in providing prophetic guidance and remaining faithful in the midst of everything, to equip us to stand and handle and offer something in the face of all of this. But also at the assembly, Bishop Moss spoke about the church, about the place that we have, about the message that we offer, about the truth that we confess. And in the process of that message, made it pretty clear that the church already does have a voice and a presence to offer in all of that. A voice and a presence that invites people to recognize this great circle of humanity, this great circle of life and grace and truth and salvation that we all of us are a part of. that make all of us brothers and sisters. On Sundays, we all come together from our different circles, from our different perspectives and messages and opinions, so that we can give all of our time and our attention to this bigger circle. This bigger circle that broadens our understanding as it joins together these generations. Generations that we read and hear a lot lately. People say that they can't understand each other, that they don't share anything in common. But here, something different is already happening, is always happening, has been happening, will continue to happen. All those different groups with their different tendencies, their different preferences, and their different ways of communicating. Here they are one body, side by side with one another in praising and learning and sharing and serving. This bigger circle opens our eyes to our need. This bigger circle isn't like the other circles. There are these smaller circles that are so confident in their certainties, but in this bigger circle we come together and we start by saying, forgive us for the wrongs that we're aware of and the wrongs that we're not aware of. And help us where we don't understand, because we don't have all the answers. This bigger circle, we all share the body and the blood of Christ. We all are sustained and filled by this life. This bigger circle where we pass the peace, where we share a prayer and a wish for health and wholeness and peace for others that we agree with, and for others that we usually don't agree with. We're called, we come to this place. We come to this place to express and to celebrate civility, grace, welcome, and reconciliation in the midst of a lot of dysfunction and isolation. The gospel that we share is the antidote to so much of the bitterness, and cynicism, frustration, and negativity around us. As with Christ in our gospel text, Synod Assembly was full of reminders that to everyone that we're a part of a much bigger and ever-widening circle that joins us through God's love and grace. As we receive reports of the ministry occurring throughout Nebraska and throughout the world that St. Paul's contributes towards and is a part of, this got reinforced over and over again. And in the fellowship and understanding and joy that we shared in that space with one another, it continued to be reinforced. And as we gather as the body of Christ here, on Saturday nights, on Sunday mornings, on Wednesday evenings, and every other time we come together as God's people, it is reinforced again. Who are our brothers and sisters? Whoever does the will of God and confesses, prays and worships and serves alongside us are our brothers and sisters. The family's getting bigger each and every day. And we're here for the sake of the world, on account of God's great love for the world, to transform the world. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. This time I'd like to invite forward those from the congregation that joined our group at Synod Assembly: Tyler Rinkle, Julie Dunham, Jeff and Holly Christensen. Pastor Edgar and Betty were also with us at Synod Assembly. They are away on vacation in Ohio presently. I've invited Jeff and Holly and Julie and Tyler forward to share a little bit about their experiences and the activities at Assembly. give it to Jeff first or to Holly first.
Well, I would just like to say thank you for allowing us to represent St. Paul's at those Synod meetings. That was the very first experience that I have ever had at one of those. And I thoroughly enjoyed it, enjoyed the fellowship, enjoyed the meetings, believe it or not. It was a really interesting process to observe and to participate in. I think it was an exceptional year because of the election for the bishop, and that was a very interesting process to me. And as Pastor Bill said this morning, just learning about the outreach and how much we touch the lives of others, either through our congregation or through the Synod, is just amazing to me. And the dollars and just the support that we provide to others is just overwhelming. I'm going to let Jeff share the rest of the story that we were asked to share, and he can give you some more details.
Thank you. I was asked, Pastor asked us to speak a little bit about some of the business part of the Synod Assembly. Of course, as most of you have heard, the primary piece of business this year was election of a bishop. Just to let you know how large the meeting was, there were 586 certified voting members from across the state. And so the conference room was big and it was full, and it was clearly full of the Holy Spirit. We had four candidates for bishop: Bishop Maz, Pastor Cordray, who is from Syracuse, Pastor Inbarusa from Omaha, and Pastor Schroeder. And I couldn't read exactly where he's from. He served in a variety of...
Messiah Lutheran here in Grand Island.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Okay. So it
he's our neighbor across town.
Yeah, it wasn't in the paperwork. Anyway, Bill Horn, who's the vice president of the ELCA and resides in Central Florida, led us through the preparation for the voting in the for the bishop. And it was just a blessing to have him there. He was a great speaker, gave some very inspirational words, talked a lot to those of us who were first-time participants in the assembly about the importance of the vote for the bishop and some of the broader aspects of things to consider for the bishop. So Bishop Maz received over 75% of the votes on the first ballot, so the first ballot is all it took to elect him. Some of the other business items included election of representatives to the 2019 churchwide assembly. So this was done by cluster, or maybe you'd call it region. Our cluster is Luke Platt. Will be represented by Pastor Glenda Pearson, who's from Ord. There were 14 people elected by cluster, and five at-large members or representatives for the Synod or the 2019 assembly from Nebraska. So 19 voting members in all, which I guess is when we had a brief minute to talk with Bill Horn, he talked about how we're one of the larger statewide synods in the country. The Synod budget was presented and voted on, and there was some debate there. A lot of the debate surrounded the reduction in the level of support for Lutheran Outdoor Ministries and Midland College.
University. Yeah.
But there was a lot of good discussion back and forth about how in challenging times we all are faced with having to balance a budget. And so it was clear to me it wasn't a very easy decision for the Synod leadership to present that budget with those reductions in it. Just a couple other items and then I'll finish. Resolutions, Pastor Bill talked about a couple of the resolutions. There was a resolution voted on for the recognition of 50 years of women in the clergy for the Synod. And then as Pastor mentioned, the one about political, social, and ideological differences and divisiveness is something that one of the committees of this of the Synod leadership is going to work on. At the banquet, as you may have heard last week, at the banquet, Pastor Edgar was recognized for his 40th anniversary of his ordination, so he achieved that milestone. Believe it or not, there was a surprising number of 45, 50th, and even 55th anniversary milestone recognized. And then lastly, Bishop Moss encouraged all of us to go back home and raise awareness of the fact that the ELCA is working on a new statement on women and social justice. And he encouraged us to go back and talk to congregations about this because he didn't want the same scenario to repeat itself as when the church released its statement on human sexuality 8 or 9 years ago, and that was a lot of surprise in congregations. That statement is available on the Synod website. The draft is about 60 or 65 pages long. I started reading it, but I'll confess I did not get through it. But if you simply search for Nebraska, ELCA Nebraska Synod in Google, you can find all of the documentation related to the assembly, as well as this upcoming statement that'll be worked on in the 2019 churchwide assembly on women and social justice. Thank you.
Thank you, Jeff.
I'm going to talk to you a little bit about our guest speaker that we had. It was Reverend Dr. Chris Alexander. She's from the Countryside Church out of Omaha, and she is part of the Tri-Faith Initiative. And what that is it's a 35-acre complex that has Jews, Muslims, and Christians. They each have their own building, so there's a mosque, a synagogue, and a church. The fourth building that's on the complex is just a interfaith building, and it's used for classes and learning more about the different faiths. There is a creek that runs through the complex. It's kind of clever because it's called Hell's Creek, and they've tried to change the name of the creek, but the people that own it won't change it. And so what they did is they just built bridges over the creek, and then on these bridges it says bridges to understanding of different faiths instead of walls of fear and confusion. And she talked about how they came about discerning to get to where they are to join this $65 million complex. The second day, she talked about spiritual practice and how their services all start with 2 minutes of nothing but breathing, and you just let everything go and just let the spirit come within you. And she said that that's what they do for all of their services, and we did that. We did a little practice of it during her one of her speeches, and it made a big difference. She did talk about how status doesn't mean anything in their church. So if you do go, and when she first meets you, all they want to know is your name and what brings you joy. And we did that little practice as well, and that was pretty clever. It was pretty nice. She talked a lot about the power of prayer, and again, about how they got to where they are, and that you just have to listen to what God is doing in this world and see what you are doing to help God accomplish that. If you want to know more about the Tri-Faith Initiative, they do have a website, just trifaithinitiative.org, and you can go out there. They've got videos, they've got different virtual tours, things like this that are on the website. One last thing that we thought was pretty clever, you don't have to be part of their congregation. You can actually, to help fund the project, they have memberships that they sell, and she compared it to a zoo membership, and so we thought that was kind of funny.
But comparing supporting church to supporting a zoo.
Yeah.
I found that kind of humorous.
It was pretty fun. So, but if you want to go out and check out the website, there's a lot of really neat stuff that's out there.
As they say, save the best for last.
Yeah!
I did a ministry fair, and it was like on the last day. And what you would do, you get this like little piece of paper, and there's about 20 plus organizations that you could go to, and when you go to them, you get like a stamp, and then they get information, or you get information about them. And I'll be talking about two, but what I noticed about all of them was that like they were like really passionate about what they were going for. There's always like three things that they talked about: what they were doing, how God was involved, and how you can carry it to your congregation. So that's what I thought was cool about. They were just all passionate about it. The two I'm going to be talking about was the writing to camp members. I thought that was like a pretty cool thing, especially since a lot of them don't get writing to their family members, or like family members don't write to them. So I thought that was pretty cool. And then also writing to inmates, you know, since they like, made a bad mistake, doesn't mean that they can't follow faith in some kind of a way. So I just wrote that God's with them and that God's going to be with their family during the tough time. So it's a really cool experience just to see all the organizations and just to learn about what they're doing for God.
Thank you, Tyler, and thank you to all of our voting members for sharing about our assembly. Invite all to stand as we continue with our worship. Now, together with the whole church, across continents and across centuries, let us confess our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Filled with the Holy Spirit, we join with the church in every place, praying for the world that God so loves. Response to the petitions concluding, "Hear us, O God, is your mercy is great." Lord God, you call your church to be one, and teach us that a house divided against itself cannot stand. Overcome our separations within the body of Christ. Make us one diverse family, brothers and sisters of Jesus. Hear us, O God. Lord God, with you there is forgiveness and hope. You love your whole creation. Help us order our lives so that human activity gives voice to that hope, and empower us to bring healing in your world. Hear us, O God. Lord God, you still walk among us, and we still hide ourselves from you out of fear. We withdraw from strangers and those unlike ourselves, the very people that you call us to love. Replace our fear with trust. Remove enmity between nations and grant us peace. We pray especially this week for you to be present and bring reconciliation, an understanding, and an honest and valuable dialogue to the foreign policy conversations with North Korea and with other nations. Hear us, O God. Lord God, your compassion continually reaches into the lives of your people. Visit with loving kindness those experiencing afflictions of any kind. Renew all of us and prepare us for glory so that we do not lose heart. Hear us, O God. By the sure guidance of your Holy Spirit, O God, we lift up our prayers in trust and in thanksgiving through Christ our Lord. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let's take a moment to share the peace of Christ with those around us. Invite the congregation to stand. We pray together. Merciful God, you open wide your hand and satisfy the need of every living thing. You have set this feast before us. Open our hands to receive it. Open our hearts to embrace it. Open our lives to live it. We pray this through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so, with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, mighty, and merciful Lord, heaven and earth are full of your glory. In great love you sent to us Jesus, your Son, who reached out to heal the sick and the suffering, who preached good news to the poor, and who on the cross opened his arms to all. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread. He gave thanks, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people, for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering, therefore, his death, resurrection, and ascension, we await his coming in glory. Pour out upon us the spirit of your love, O Lord, and unite the wills of all who share in this heavenly food, the body and blood of Jesus Christ, our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. We join one another as a family of faith as we pray in the words our Savior taught. Our Father, who art congregation may be seated. Come and let us eat, for now the feast is spread. All are welcome. Welcome all to stand as we prepare to go and serve. May the body and the blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, strengthen you and keep you in true faith unto life everlasting. Amen. We pray together. Jesus Christ, host of this meal, you have given us not only this bread and cup, but your very self, that we may feast on your great love. Filled again by these signs of your grace, may we hunger for your reign of justice. May we thirst for your way of peace, for you are Lord forevermore. Amen. And now may God, whose power working in us can do infinitely more than we can ask or imagine, grant you the gifts of faith and hope. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever. Amen. Now go in peace. The Spirit sends us forth to serve.